share tonight with you my testimony.
I was born in the winter of 1956 in Cookstown, way out in the sticks. We moved to Belfast when it was six. We moved to Rathcoole, the biggest house in the state in Northern Ireland, and that's true. At that time it was mixed, there was Catholics too. This was before all the troubles began. We used to live around about four rows down from Bobby Sands. We used to play football together on the front with mucky faces and boggy hands. But this was all before all the troubles began. We used to run around the estate just some troublesome lads. But one day coming home from school, everything changed. I seen a gang of lads I knew from school and they were shouting my name. So I walked over and says, "What's the crack, kids?" They said, "Listen, Davey, you're a Protestant and we're all Catholics, so we're gonna beat you up and throw you into the river." I said, "Why?" They said, "You said you're a prod." I said, "No, I never." They said, "Yes, you did, you're going into the river." They beat me up and then they threw me in. That day I learned two lessons. One, learn to swim. Two, don't play with Catholics, they're bad news. And that's how it was from that day forward in Rathcoole. 1972, we were only kids, but we had hardened minds. Back then I thought the smartest thing for me to do was join the tartan gangs. We would set upon them. At first we would smash their windies, later we would petrol bomb them. We would burn them out of their homes. Some people would say we lived the wrong life. I spent the 18th birthday as a political prisoner, locked up in Long Kaish. I got released, but the same week I was out planting bombs and robbing banks, while at the same time trying to live a modest life. But I got arrested again and broke the officer's nose to say thanks. Yeah, we get back in jail, we had military status and we called ranks. We had bomb making classes in the morning in prison and weapon training in the afternoons, with some live bullets, not blanks. Thanks to the troubles in the streets, there were more tanks. And in my mind, I wanted to do more, cause if I'm doing this, I'm doing this raw. I wanna join the most feared terror group of them all. I put the word out around the jail, the packy wants to be an Ulster volunteer. And 2 weeks later when I got released, there was a knock at my door saying, "Is it true you wanted to join?" I said, "Yes I do." They said, "Think it over, cause once you do you don't leave." I said, "No, I believe this is a cause worth fighting for. It's a cause worth living and a cause worth dying for."
And I said, "Why not? I'm a loyalist, I've all these tattoos on my arm. No surrender for God and Ulster. Remember 1690 and everything." And I thought, "No, I believe in this. This is a good cause." And I thought, "Well, if you're still going to be a terrorist, you may as well be a good terrorist." And I thought, the most feared group in Northern Ireland in the paramilitary scene is the UBF. They're very militant and they're very secretive. And you can't just join this group, you must be invited by them to be a member. A week later I went with these men and they took me to a bar in Belfast and brought me upstairs into a room. There was three men sitting behind a table and they had an Ulster flag over the table. And there was something else sitting on the table, and I am sure this will surprise you, because you know what it was? One of these, a Bible. And the guy in the middle said to me, "Do you believe in the Protestant cause?" And I said, "I do." He says, "Are you prepared to die for the Protestant cause?" And I says, "I am." He says, "Are you prepared to kill for the Protestant cause?" And I says, "I am."
Carried on in my mission and moved up in position. Done everything that you could envision. My whole life revolved around the organization. Became an area commander, turned streets into military stations. I got arrested with the rest of my team because a snitch turned super grass and give the police information. We got sentenced to court, so I told my team to dress in uniform for the occasion. We got lined up on the docks like thunderbirds. He called my name and then the list of offenses. Then he sentenced me to 48 years in the underworld. He said I'd serve at least 12 at the minimum. I turned my back on the judge like I wasn't even listening. I saw my mother stood at the back of the court with tears running down her face. She looked at me and said, "You're a hopeless case, you're never gonna change." I said, "Go home and get my headpiece, ma, they could take away in chains." I thought I'd never see the light of day again. But meanwhile, my mom didn't go home. She went to tell my relatives what happened, and there was a wee woman sat in her room. She said, "Mrs. Hamilton, I believe that God can change your son." My mom said, "Thank you, but I've done all that can be done." Before starting to cry, she said, "What is to become of my son? I never wanted this." The wee woman said, "Don't you be worrying, love, I'm putting him on my wanted list." She said, "I believe God's grace creates changes." She said, "I don't believe in hopeless cases." She said, "I don't believe in hopeless cases." Listen, about a week went by and I was sat in my cell, thinking about life and how I'm trapped in hell. I saw a piece of paper lay on my bed. I picked it up and it read, Jesus Christ is coming back soon. I laughed and said, alright, do a cinema near you. I ripped it up and threw it straight in the bin. I made myself a cup of tea without taking it in. But the next thing that happened was very strange. I heard a voice in my head saying, David, it's time to change, become a Christian. Well, I thought that I was slipping or tripping, cause I was mis-sipping and burnt my lip in my tea. I said, I know what's happening here. These fellas playing a trick on me. The slip trips in my tea, so I poured it out and looked down the sink. I couldn't see no tabs, then I started to think, what if the voice that I heard was right? What if all these years it was God that spurred my life? Cause I've been shot 3 times, stabbed in the head with an axe and survived. I've been blown up in a bomb, there's been many attempts on my life. The fact that I'm even alive is a reason to believe in the divine. I realized I was deceived in the mind, so I got down on my knees and I started to cry. Asked the Lord for forgiveness. I said, Lord, let me be your witness. Please rid me of the bigotry and leave me sinless. Let me spread your word, I'll go about your heavenly business. My life, let me live this. And from that minute on, I felt freedom in my soul, even though I was in prison.
I thank the Lord Jesus Christ most of all that what he's done in my life, that he has given me a story. And I believe it tells people that there's no such thing as a hopeless case. If that was true, if that were really true, then you're looking at one, a hopeless case. And I really do thank God we get an opportunity just to share. You know, I said today, you know, some of the best brains in England is trying to find a solution to bring the North and the South and the Protestant and the Catholic together. And yet today we could stand before people and say, we know a solution that works. That's because Jesus Christ is Lord. And we are reconciled not only with God, but with our fellow man. Because God changes the heart. It's not a United Kingdom or a united Ireland, but it's God's kingdom. That's what it comes down to. God's kingdom. God's kingdom.